few announcements this morning. As you can also see on the screen behind me, we have visitor cards in the pews. If you're a guest, we'd love for you to fill one of those out for us. Here's why. We can let you know what we're doing here at Mercy United Methodist Church, and also why we do what we do. We also have prayer cards in the pews as well, whether it's a public prayer request, which means that we'll place in the program and pray for each other, or if it's a private prayer request, that means it's for my eyes only. Either way, those prayer requests, fill out the card, drop it off in the offering plate on your way out of the sanctuary today, and we'll get those into the program for those that are to be prayed for each other. Also, you can find in the back of the sanctuary printed copies of today's sermon or close to what will come out of my mouth. They're back there for your viewing pleasure or just total destruction, whatever works for you. Take that home if you like, or if you would like them today during the service, please go ahead and grab one. Also, Experiencing God growth groups, they're still going on. It's not too late to join a group. If you want to get a hint or a taste of what these groups can look like for the future, check it out. The dates and meeting times are on the screen behind me. I would suggest that you give it a chance or find that it's worth your time. You also, there are in the back of the sanctuary there as well, I think there are at this door that I didn't check this morning, free devotionals for Lent, which begins April 1st. April 1st, whoa, where am I at? March 1st, which is Ash Wednesday, but not April, March. Jesus and the Gospels there at the doors. If you'd like to take one, please do so as we work through Lent together. Youth group tonight, 6:30 to 8 o'clock. Tomorrow night, Marvelous Mondays. Also, if you're interested, especially for some of the kids in Marvelous Mondays, collecting items for the shoeboxes for Operation Christmas Child. If you are interested or like to check that out, check out the program. Details should be in there. See Sandra Rogers as well. It was incredible to see the number of boxes we were able to collect throughout last year. So we're starting that up again. So give it a chance. It's a beautiful thing to be able to help a needy kid, whether here in the United States or elsewhere, with a Christmas gift. Many of whom have heard stories that these boxes sometimes are the only Christmas gift the kids will receive. Church Fun Day, that would be February 26th, which is, guess what, next Sunday from 2 to 4 o'clock at Cool Spring Fitness. We'll take over the joint. The pool's ours for an hour. The climbing wall's ours for an hour. The gym's ours for 2 hours. Then they'll probably have to recover after a while. But that's next Sunday, 2 to 4 o'clock. Still plenty of time to sign up. Just make sure you sign up downstairs outside of the wall, or if you're following the Facebook page, make sure you post it. You'll be there on the Facebook page. Those details. Follow through if you're interested in going. I know it was a blast last year, and too many people were excited about trying to drown me again this year. That part I'm not too happy about. But we'll move on. If you order strombolis from the preschool, they will be here Wednesday, 3 to 4:30 here at the church. Make sure you pick up your stromboli, or some, if you leave them in the freezer, you never know who will eat them, since I have keys to the church. And also tomorrow night, craft group will also be meeting here. Bring your $5 and get ready to light up your world. Is that what the slogan is? Light up your life? I'm sorry. Make sure you check with Karen and April for any more details if you'd like. If you ask me, I know nothing. 6:30? Okay. Karen just told me 6:30, so get here at 6:30 or look out. You'll miss out. Friends, why don't we greet one another with the love of Christ?
Good morning. Good morning.
you stand with me as we prepare ourselves for worship, or during our call to worship? Adapted from Isaiah chapter 52. How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news.
Beautiful are those who bring peace and good news, and proclaim salvation.
Our God reigns.
Our God reigns.
Let us lift up our voices in song, bursting for joy.
The Lord's strength will be shown, and all people will see the salvation of our God.
And so, my friends, let's worship together. quite simply. Jesus, before he went to heaven, he told his disciples this from Matthew chapter 28. He gave them a job to do, so they made sure that they told good news wherever they went. He put it like this. Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth is given to me. Go, therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. And lo, I will be with you always to the end of the age." So we have that in the back of the wall there to remind us about Jesus' promise that he'd be with us, which is great news. But some of the best news is that Jesus is alive, that he brings about life and hope. So I've got a job for you. Yeah? You guys willing to do this? Because I asked the adults to do it last week. I even tried to do it, and it was hard. But I actually share with somebody how great Jesus is. Okay? Tell somebody. Yeah, somebody. Do you have any help with that? I'll help you. Why? Yeah, tell somebody how great Jesus is. So how might you do that? Oh, I don't know. You share something from your lunch with somebody at the table, you can tell them, well, you know, Jesus would have me do that. Or for some of us, invite somebody to Marvelous Mondays, because we get to learn about Jesus. You can figure that out on your own. But to share the best news, great news, about how great Jesus is. You want to do that? Maybe. We'll find out, won't we? It's one thing to be up here. It's a whole other thing to do it with somebody else. But why don't we pray? Father, give us courage. Give us the words. Thank you so much that you sent the best news about the good news of Jesus. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, the Bible talks about how when Jesus first called his disciples and they were fishermen, he said, "I will make you fishers of men," as they shared the gospel. Guess what? So I've got a little fish for you. So if you guys like it, grab a bag. Actually, grab two. You can share. It would be great if you shared it with somebody else. Maybe you can tell them why you did. Friends, what do you want to give God thanks for this morning? What would you like to praise God for who God is? Is there anything we need to be praying about? Bonnie. For a young man who had bilateral pneumonia and was in a coma, now he's up and about walking. What a beautiful change of events. Praise be to God. Thanks, Bonnie. Friends, is there anything else we need to be praying for?
I'm okay, too. Was injured when he fell from the ceiling. Just having surgery on Tuesday. So it's going to feel better from his neck than he was feeling.
So Sandra's uncle, Dave King, thank you. I'm slow. Dave King, who fell and they're fusing his... bones in his neck. So they're going to do that Tuesday. So be praying for Dave King. Thanks, Andrew. Friends, is there anything else we need to be praying for? Linda.
I just want to praise God. Our little granddaughter was in the hospital this week with complications from the flu. And we saw her last night, and she's bouncing around and playing and better. So please praise God for his goodness.
Now, which granddaughter was it? Yeah. That's okay, because I didn't see her at the preschool this week. Okay. So thanks be to God that Kennedy, after having to be in the hospital with complications from the flu, is feeling better. Thanks, Linda. Karen.
I'd like to pray for our country.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Praying for our country. Thanks, Karen. Friends, is there anything else? Dale.
Well, my brother, he's fighting pneumonia. When he got a flu shot, and then he got the flu, and then he got the pneumonia. So he goes to see two doctors this week to see about his lungs.
Okay. So keep praying for Terry, who not only had the flu, but now has pneumonia as well. Thanks, Dale. Friends, is there anything else? Ben, why don't we go to the Lord together in prayer? Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. Father, as the sunlight shines through the windows this morning, it's hard not to be happy. But even better than happiness is joy, the kind of joy that you bring about then, the worst of days, the darkest of days, and we still have that sense of wonder and excitement and happiness, not based on the surroundings around us, but based instead of who you are. Father, fill us with joy. We can talk as much as we want to about sharing our faith with other folks, but if we do it with our faces, are we even really sharing the wonder and excitement of who you are? We thank you that you allow us to have joy in a world that's filled with darkness and hurt and pain. Whoever's in office, it seems like it's a world filled with darkness and hurt and pain. So we pray for our country, Father. Guide and direct it. My country, 'tis of thee. And yet too often, we slide into bickering and fighting, and it doesn't matter who's in the Oval Office. Somehow with politics, we forget who we are. We're praying, Father, for peace for our country, peace for our troops. Pray for peace in Afghanistan, Iraq, Syria, Aleppo. We come before you, Father, asking for you to do the work. We pray for our country here, Father. Pray for guidance for our leaders, whether it's President Trump and his cabinet, for Congress, for the Supreme Court, for the governor in Pennsylvania, with our governor, for those in elected offices here, even locally, in the midst of the dangers and the troubles we have with rampant use of drugs and the other side effects that occur because of such drug use. Father, it is a dark, painful place. And yet when we look outside the windows this morning, we're reminded that there's still joy. And yet even more so, whether it's overcast today or the glorious sunshine shining in now, we can still have joy because of who you are. We pray for our country. We pray for your spirit to guide and direct. And yet our hope's in you. We've seen your hand at work. You are a God who is moving in our midst. We praise and thank you for the healing of Matt Rocco. We ask, why don't you continue to bring about healing in Matt, who's a friend of Bonnie Jordan's daughter. We lift before you, Kennedy, as we praise you for healing in Kennedy after her battle with the flu this week in hospital stay. Thanks be to God, Father. We thank you for healing in Kennedy. So, Father, we come before you. We're still praying for healing for Terry. We pray for him in the midst of the flu and pneumonia. We pray for healing for him, that you guide and direct. We ask, Father, that you be with Dave King. Bring about healing in him, Father. Lord, thank you so much that you bless us with joy. Joy that this world doesn't have the final say. That there is life after death. That Jesus is alive. We have hope. We have joy. Father, we thank you and praise you. As we praise Jesus, talk to us with prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Friends, let's worship together. from Luke chapter 24, verses 46 through 48, and Acts chapter 5, verses 17 through 32. As Cassie makes her way forward, also, I forgot to mention this morning as well, the church words insert is still there. We have quite a few thank you. But there's a word that we use in church that you don't understand, don't know, or want to hear more about. Maybe it's a topic. Fill one of these out. Drop it in the offering plate on your way out today. Morning, Cassie.
Tell people all about this new life. At daybreak, they entered the temple courts as they had been told, and began to teach the people. When the high priest and his associates arrived, they called together the Sanhedrin, the full assembly of the elders in Israel, and sent to jail for the apostles. But on arriving at the jail, the officers did not find them there, so they went back and reported. We found the jail securely locked, with the guards standing at the doors, but when we opened them, we found no one inside. On hearing this report, the captain of the temple guard and the chief priests were at a loss, wondering what this might lead to. When someone came and said, "Look, the men put in jail are standing in the temple courts teaching the people." At that, the captain went with his officers and brought the apostles. They did not use force because they feared that the people would stone them. The apostles were brought and made to appear before the Sanhedrin to be questioned by the high priest. "You gave us your orders not to teach in his name," he said. "Yet you filled Jerusalem with your teaching and are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood." Peter and the other apostles replied, "We must obey God rather than human things. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead, whom he killed by hanging him on the cross. God exalted him to his own right hand as Prince and Savior, that he might bring Israel to the cross and bear their sins. We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him."
Friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. And then we forgot to pray for it, didn't we, this morning? Please forgive me. I'm forgetful. Cassie, thank you. Can't keep quiet. And Marvelous Mondays, we have moments where the kids just have problems shutting up. You wouldn't know it this morning by the children's message, but when folks, kids are in a place where they feel comfortable and safe, it is tough to get them to keep quiet. You know, it's fascinating for us as Christians. Sometimes it's so easy for us to keep quiet. We have the best news in the world. And yet, it's so simple for us to keep quiet. You know, as we hear from the scriptures this morning, that the apostles were sent and they were to be witnesses of these things, according to Jesus. In other words, tell people what you've seen. What have you experienced? Let them know. As they are arrested, the apostles told the Sanhedrin, "We must obey God rather than men." In other words, we can't shut up because you told us to shut up. God gave us the chance to shut up. And the question that happened is, who shared your faith that you have now? Who shared it with you? Where did it come from? What might have happened if they never shared it? See, it's easy. It's simple for us to fall into the trap of keeping quiet. But is that good? I would suggest it's not. My hope is that we can't keep quiet. My hope is that we can't keep quiet. Because what happens if we don't share? There's a sweet grandmother who called the hospital, and she talked with the operator who answered the phone and said, "Can you tell me information on Norma Finley? She's in room 302. Norma Finley in 302? Who may I ask is calling?" And Norma said, "Oh, a family member." "Okay." Or, I'm sorry, the woman called, said, "Norma's a family member. Let me go check." So she called the nurse's station. She heard from the nurse's station. She called. She got back on the line and spoke to the grandmother who called. I can tell you this. Norma Finley has been, she'll be released tomorrow. She has great. Her blood work came back. Her blood pressure's fine. Everything looks good. Normal. The doctor is so pleased. And the grandmother said, "Thank you, I've been so worried. Thank you for the great news." The operator replied, "You're welcome. Is Norma your daughter?" "Oh no," said the grandmother. "I'm Norma Finley. I'm in 302. They just won't tell me anything." We can do a great job of keeping quiet, but that's not what we should do. We're called to share. As Christians, we fall into the trap of, maybe you've watched the movie Fight Club. If nothing else, it was one that, after I watched it, it took me weeks to stop thinking about it. We're not showing a clip today because it's a violent, rough movie. And yet, there are two roles of Fight Club. This group of guys who were so fed up with their jobs that they would, after work, meet in basements and parking garages and just punch each other senseless until one of them was standing, the other one was on the ground. Here are the two rules for Fight Club that show up in the very beginning. Ready for this? The first rule of Fight Club is this: you do not talk about Fight Club. Second rule of Fight Club is this: you do not talk about Fight Club. Yet as Christians, we can fall into the trap: you do not talk about Jesus. What are those rules, but don't you talk about in polite society when you're at a dinner meeting or whatever? What are you going to talk about? Politics and religion. We've been trained to keep quiet. And yet, from our readings this morning, whether it's from Jesus himself or the apostles when they've been arrested and beaten, the response they have is this: we can't keep quiet. Why would we keep quiet? Either way, we're called to not keep quiet. See, we're called not to keep quiet. The apostles, they were thrown in jail. They were called to obey. And whenever they were accosted by the Sanhedrin, after being beat, berated, then they would go to court. They had beatings that would occur later on in Acts chapter 5. They spend a night in prison, and then the angel breaks them out in the middle of the night so they can go preach out in the courtyard. I mean, how stupid is this if you just want to stay out of trouble? You're in prison for talking about Jesus. An angel breaks you out, so what do? You go talk about Jesus the next day. Duh, this doesn't make much sense unless you have a higher calling. Don't we? They had to obey God rather than that. From Voice of the Martyrs, their January 2017 edition, this story came about. A pastor from an Islamic country who would not be named to protect this pastor as well as this young woman who we'll hear about. Well, he shared the story about Shani. My guess is how you say her name. It's spelled S-H-A-N-I in English. Shani. Her husband was the leader of a local house church, but one night he was arrested by the local police because in that Muslim country, it was illegal to talk about Jesus. Now Shani, she knew that her husband was brave, but as she prayed after her husband was arrested, she said, "God, please, please protect me. I'm scared. I'm terrified. If the police take me, I know I'll spill the beans. I know I'll tell them all about our secret house church. I know I'll share all the names. I may even deny my faith. God, don't let them come get me." 6 o'clock in the morning, the knock at the door, and there are the police to take her away. "God, what are you doing? What happens? It's your fault." That's the way she tells the story. "I can't handle torture," she started praying on her way to the police station. "God, protect me. I can't handle this. I can't do anything. Please, Lord, protect me." She gets to the police station. They throw her into a jail cell, and she sits there in the dark. It smells like a sewer. She came from an upper-class family. This is not how life is supposed to be led. Dark, gloomy, no food. It smells like a sewer. She's stuck there all day. At around 2 o'clock in the morning, suddenly there are two guards at the door, rip open the door and say, "Come, follow us." She's terrified as a guard escorts her down the hallway. She prays to herself and says, "God, please protect me, please help me." And yet, as they sat her down in the room with the interrogator looking at her across the table, the words are recorded of this. The only thing she could say was, "Dear God, Lord." And then suddenly she felt God's presence and peace. Goes on to say, Shani looked at the interrogator. "I have a right to evangelize," she says, "and I'm happy that I'm evangelizing. It may be illegal here, but I'm happy to evangelize. We're supposed to evangelize, which means I'm supposed to share my faith. This is the commandment from Jesus. Everyone needs to hear this good news. You need to hear this good news too. God sent me here to tell you about Jesus. You're a poor man," She says this to the interrogator. Where did this come from? I'm terrified. I'm scared. And yet she's told him, you're a poor man. I feel bad for you. You don't have peace. You don't have joy. You don't have hope. You don't even know why you're alive. The only way to the truth is Jesus Christ. You're an interrogator now, but one day you're going to stand before the ultimate judge, Jesus Christ, and he's going to examine you. Without him, there is no hope for you. And Jesus is going to ask you, why'd you do this to my servants? The interrogator's not used to this. Most people come in there cowering, looking like they're about to wet themselves. And instead, this terrified girl looks at him with power that was not her own and came right back at the interrogator. He was after getting over a shock, he was infuriated and said, get back to your cell. Your punishment has now been doubled. Johnny's strength would seem to leave her as soon as she got back to herself. God, why did you make me do that? I'm going to die here. This is all your fault. I can't do this anymore. She sat in that dark cell without food all day long. And around 2 o'clock in the morning, then she hears it again. The guards take her to the interrogation room. She sits down and she's filled with fear. Suddenly she's in the room and it changes to peace. In joy, with courage, she shares her faith again, telling that interrogator that she feels sorry for him. This gets him really wound up. Throws her back into her cell. Cuts off water for the day. She's left there again until, for the third time, the next day at 2 o'clock in the morning, they come to take her back to the interrogation room. They sit her down in the chair. The interrogator looks at her with anger in his eyes as she says the same things again. Furiously, he threatens her life, says, go back to your cell. We'll deal with you tomorrow. Shani couldn't sleep, and she waited for death. And then around 4 or 5 in the morning, she heard it again. And the door opened, and she thought, death is coming. She saw the interrogator at the room and at the entrance to the door by himself. And he said, don't worry. I will not harm you. I want to ask you a favor. Would you pray for me? The interrogator entered Shani's cell with tears in his eyes. How did you know that God sent you here at this particular time in my life? He asked. The past 3 days I've been going through hell. How did you know that my life is so crazy, so messed up? I tried everything in my religion and could never find peace. I learned today that the only Savior is Jesus Christ. Please help me to be saved. The interrogator stayed in Shani's cell for 3 hours, and before he left, he placed his faith in Jesus Christ. Then he ordered the release of both Shani and her husband on the secret condition that they agreed to meet privately with him to disciple him, which means help him to be a Christian. How's that work? You must obey God rather than men. She couldn't keep quiet. In spite of herself, she couldn't keep quiet. Where's that come from? 1 John chapter 4, which we talked about last week, is a fun, terrifying verse for me because it reminds me that perfect love drives out fear. I guess when Shani, filled with the terror of where she had fixed her eyes on Jesus. And suddenly that love that he has for her and that he has for us drove the fear away. And yet, if you're like me, it's hard to share your faith. But the calling isn't that it should be easy. The calling in our lives is that we ought to have mouths so we can keep quiet. So the calling in our lives is that we can't keep quiet. Let me give you a second. Who shared faith with you first? Who is that person who first shared faith with you? Some of you have smiles on your faces. A few of you have grimaces, and a couple of you are napping. That's okay. Who shared faith with you? What would happen if they kept their mouth shut? Too often we can fall into the trap of keeping quiet, and as churches, forgetting what we're all about. So there's an oldie but goodie story. On a dangerous sea coast where shipwrecks often occurred, there was once a crude life-saving station. The building was no more than a hut. And there was only one boat and a few devoted members who were there to make sure that if ships wrecked off the coast, that the life-saving station was ready to go out and save those people. The boats had holes in them. They barely really worked. They weren't even well equipped for dealing with the choppy, dangerous waters, but they were willing and they were able and they saved many people's lives. As news about this life-saving station grew, more and more people started to want to join. It went from those weird folks to, man, we really want to be part of this. They're doing something important with life. They're doing something worthwhile. But as more people joined, they started to realize that, oh boy, these boats are just not adequate for the waters. We need new boats. Try out some fundraisers. Not only that, but they realized also the hut they were in was just not big enough or comfortable enough to make sure that they were ready for when people's boats may be capsized offshore. Not only that, but if you brought in people who were sopping wet, you needed some place besides a drafty, cold, holes-in-the-walls hut. So they started to build a new building to make sure that the life-saving station was up to code and that people would be safe whenever they were brought in. After a while, the life-saving station became the place to be. It went from being this old, run-down hut where people were intentional about saving those whose boats had been capsized, too. It was cool. It was the hip place to be, going back to my 80s youth. It was the place that you wanted to be popular, the place you wanted to be if you were important. Soon, membership dues became more and more expensive to be part of the life-saving station. And as the membership dues grew, it was fascinating to watch that it became more and more difficult to folks to have excitement about going out to save people. And actually, what was even more fascinating is how comfortable the folks in the life-saving station had become. So comfortable that when a terrible storm ripped through that seaside village and a boat was offshore and capsized, many of the people in the life-saving station didn't even want to go out. A few members went out and braved the waters, and they brought in many people, and a few sadly died. But they were able to save many more than if they had not gone out. But the members who went out that night looked at the well-lit, music-blaring life-saving station, where many other members were in their comfortable as they were risking their lives. Those men and women who had gone out that night and risked the waters came in and were frustrated with those who stayed behind. What's sad is those who stayed behind didn't even want the people who came in sopping wet who had been on the boat that had capsized. They didn't even want them to come inside. You may get the floor dirty. You know, we just had that wax. Be careful over there. That's a new couch. No. Don't have them stand over there. Just please stand on the linoleum. That's the best place. Not over the carpeting. When they next met for their monthly meeting at the life-saving station, a huge disagreement broke out. Some of the members who were more comfortable and had not gone out in the midst of the terrible storm said, you know, it's a dangerous thing to go out into the waters. And the people who came in, they really did trash our beautiful space. Yet there were those who had risked their lives who had gone out in the midst of the waters. And their frustration was palpable as they looked at those other folks and said, you do know that we are called a life-saving station. We're here to save people's lives. We are not just to be comfortable. Well, the anger rose and people's disagreements grew so much so that when the vote was taken for what they would be about the life-saving station, suddenly became a place where people went to enjoy themselves. A few folks, many of whom had gone out that night and risked the waves, they left, bought another beat-up old shack, and use that to help save people's lives. We can do the same thing here. We can lose sight of what's most important. It is way too easy. It's so simple to keep our mouth shut instead of can't keep quiet. It is all too simple. Last week's assignment from worship was this. Let me read it off because it's the same thing almost that we have in there today. The second part of the assignment was, with one of the two people you shared with, last week's assignment was, show someone love this week and tell them why you did it. Somebody who went to church, somebody who's not a Christian. I did that this week. Tiffany, you're not ready for this, but there was Tiffany. So last week, here's our janitor, our custodian. And the recyclables, the cardboard boxes, I don't know what happened, but this week they looked like they were rabbits because they just kept on piling up. It looked like the pile was almost to the ceiling. It's here last week, and I'm part of the problem with the cardboard. I know it. So Tuesday, before Tiffany got here to take out the trash, I cut up all the boxes, put them all into one box, made sure that they all were together, barely could carry the thing onto the curb, dropped it off at the curb, came back inside. There is a simple thing. You just do that and you keep it quiet. Because, Jesus said, don't let your right hand know what your left hand's doing. But I'm the goober who gave the assignment last week. I better at least, partially do my homework, don't you think? So there I am afterwards as I ran into Tiffany in the church and I said, you can ask Tiffany her version of it. I just felt like, Tiffany, guess what? I took out the cardboard. That's what it felt like. I'm supposed to have this all down. Y'all all think I've got this all together. Oh, I took out the cardboard because I'm sorry. Because of the love of Jesus. Real smooth. She may have a different version of it. That's what it felt like. If you didn't fall through that assignment last week, not because it's easy, but it's a starting point. Because for some of us, we're terrified to even talk about Jesus. Well, it's not as though you suddenly can go from sitting in the pew, not saying anything about Christ, to get up here and act like Billy Graham. It doesn't work that way. We take steps. I don't know about you, but normally whenever you're 4-year-old, they don't start to drive in a car, right? It's called a tricycle. In my world, it's a big wheel.
Yes.
Whatever it is, we take steps. Part of the assignment from last week was to take a step. Show somebody love, tell them why. For me, it's because of the love of Jesus. So your assignment for this week is twofold. The second part is with one of the two people you shared why you love them. Wow, boy, that is just poor old grammar. With one of the two people you shared why you showed them love from last week, follow up with them to talk about your faith. Or start thinking about what your own faith story is. When Jesus told the disciples in Luke's gospel, go share. Let me rephrase it because I think I'm just butchering the scriptures here. Jesus said, this is what's written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. Well, you weren't there when Jesus rose from the dead, but you are a witness of what he's done in your life. So maybe it's working on your own faith story. Why do you believe what you believe? You don't have to have all the answers. I don't. But I do know who the answer is. Either tell somebody why, follow up with them, tell them why you show them love. Or if you didn't do it last week, I encourage you, don't do it like me. Don't go like Goofy Brian here, but instead, show someone love. Better yet, show two folks love. Tell them why. If you're up for it, go for it. It's not easy for some of us. But you never know what God might do. Remember our story with Shani in the jail? You never know what God might do. The other part of the assignment is quite simply this. As we wrap up, read through chapter 25 and experiencing God. Go to a growth group. This week's assignment is pretty simple. Next week's is almost as simple, readings-wise. But the hope is that you can't keep quiet. The hope is that we can't stop talking about the one who brought about life for us. You and I were witnesses of these things, if nothing else but what God's done in our life. You don't have to have all the answers, but you can talk about what he's done in you. The disciples, when they're thrown in prison, they're beaten, they're berated in a courtroom, they're made fun of and ridiculed. Their response was, we must obey God rather than men. Why do you and I keep quiet? I guess I'd rather obey Brian rather than men. Because who shared faith with you? What would happen if they hadn't shared? My friends, let's not keep quiet. You have the best news to share. Do you have to be discussing about it? Do you have to beat people over the head? No, because I don't think that's love. But if you're not willing to share your faith, then I'm concerned about where your faith is. So if you're like me, I need to pray for that. So if you would you pray with me? Here's how we pray. At least here for the end of our sermons. I encourage you to hold your palms up towards heaven as we talk with God. Then repeat after me. If you'd like to read the prayer, it's on the screen. I encourage you instead to give this time up to God as we close our eyes in prayer. So my friends, let us pray. Lord God, loving Father.
Lord God, loving Father.
I love you.
I love you.
I want others to know and love you.
Grant me courage.
Thank you that you love me.
Thank you that you love me.
You love me enough that Jesus died for me.
You love me enough that Jesus died for me.
I pray in the name of Jesus.
I pray in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Until that day comes, God's got a job for you and for me. As weak and wimpy as we may be when we share, God still wants to use you and use me. He can do anything he wants. He has that ability. We know, we read in the scriptures about sending angels. But he wants to use you and me. Maybe, just maybe, if we use weak instruments like us, then it's obvious how strong God is. God wants to use you. So, my hope is that you can keep quiet. To leave here today, my friends. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and in giving you strength and courage, may he give you peace. Amen. Amen.